just made about entrance space. Now, although I said that, I'm on the set, now I'm on the different space, you know, we've got the concentration which goes. I can feel the reports. It makes the case that there isn't no concentration of HMOs. No structural leak, you know, the same spider, and you know, it was found that there's no concentration. You know, I'd be more sure, but in my view, you know, anecdotally, you know, I think that there's a clarification of the policy that's HMO type proxies, you know, within that wider area. But if you need an assurance, you're not particularly, you know, given the evidence, that's not the case. So no balls, false motion, but there's a way of maybe, you know, revisiting it and, you know, have no wider search.
I've made the point, I mean, you've just referred to Wallasey, whether that's the constituency of Wallasey or the four wards at the moment. Well, there will be figures. Figures will be, you know, available that will show tenure and will form in due course part of the local plan. Then we will know how many two, three bedroom, how many HMO we actually need for demand. We don't have that evidence and we can't make it up.
Barry Manners said before, I also think that under the circumstances from your advice, Stuart, and the officers, in terms of 20% from the HMO footage, would meet our policy requirements if we had one. I do also think that there is a requirement to bring areas that are going into disrepair back into life. And so if the option is a property stays derelict, or we make it into HMOs that are reasonable in size and would meet our policy if we have one, then I would prefer to see places for people to live. And Steve said about living above a shop. Well, when I first went down to London, I lived above a shop for a long time, had to cop my leg over a fire escape to get up and come and do the shopping. So we've all been there at times in the past. And so I do believe that it is, for me, I think it is better to bring an area up, even if that starts off with HMOs possibly, as long as we feel that they are of a standard that would meet your council's policy if we have one.
Okay, so we have a proposal. On the table. So Julie seconded, got it there first. Well done, Paul. Do we need to hear it again, or I mean, we have it's a refusal.
As the second, I think what Paul was saying is that it's in contravention of policy HS 14. I think is what you were going to say, isn't it, Paul? In the fact that the policy results in results in a concentration of HMOs in a particular area. So the character of this area is adversely affected. I think that's what you were saying.
Okay, let's test it. Okay, let me see those in favour of the reason for refusal moved by Councillor Stewart. Those in favour? That's lost the votes to 6. I'll move approval from the chairman. Is that seconded?
I'll second.
Okay. Can you see those in favour of approval, please?
I think that's what I said.
Yes. yes. Okay, that application now is approved 7-6. Thank you for that.
Gentlemen, councillors, thank you for doing it. I'm sure there will be a return.
Thanks for that. We now move to agenda item. Agenda item 4, which is application of Little Mundens disposal fee for FARR HALL DRIVE, HESWALL. If you have some introduction, please.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Chair. This application is a demolition of an existing dwelling house and construction of a new replacement dwelling. The proposed dwelling has a larger footprint than the existing property. The architectural composition is considered to be traditional with twin bays and central entrance. As we know, described our architectural style within this part of FARR HALL DRIVE is considered to be acceptable. With regards to landscaping, it is considered to perform an important aesthetic role in joining a diverse architectural environment, and the local authority is satisfied this can be served by a suitably worded condition. There is a blanket tree preservation order across the site, which prevents important landscaping across the front of the site, certainly being without the consent of the local authority. The council's tree officer has raised no objections to the proposal, but has suggested that additional conditions should be applied, which requires a submission of an architectural method statement to be drawn up. The proposal meets the requirements of distances, and there are no objections from officers, higher officers or rural wildlife in terms of ecology. For these reasons, the proposal is considered to be acceptable and is recommended for approval subject to the attached conditions and an additional condition requiring submission of an architectural method statement.
Okay, thanks for that. It's before us because there is a qualified petition. Is there a representative of the petitioners who would like to speak to us? No? Okay. Is the applicant here? Would they like to speak to us or their agent? No? Okay. Is there more council? Already in position.
Thank you, Chair. My name is Councillor Eswell and I'm the Ward of Eswell. Mr. Chairman, fellow councillors, thank you for the opportunity to address the committee this evening. Our main objections, apart from others, this application is based around our own council's policy, HS4. It emphasises the importance of safeguarding the character of established residential areas. FARR HALL DRIVE is undoubtedly an attractive residential area, characterised by dwellings set in large mature gardens. It is a right-of-way and a cycling and walking path, enjoying the value by Wirral residents and visitors. The number of personal objections is 127 signatures from residents on the petition, only serves to emphasise the feeling about this application. FARR HALL DRIVE has a distinctive character that we should be looking to protect in line with HS4. Indeed, that is just what this committee is seeking to do. The officer's report makes mention of the previous application, APP 18-01-234. Which we refused in April. But quite why the report does not mention that our refusal is still the subject of an appeal, or why the report does not assess the current proposal in the context of the previous refusal is beyond comprehension. The report has completely failed to consider key facts. The previous application was for extensions to the existing house and a new house to the side of it. This is obviously a different type of a proposal in that it proposes to replace the existing dwelling with a new one. However, it raises exactly the same types of issues. Your previous refusal was on the basis that the proposal was of a scale that would be unacceptable in relation to the character of housing on FARR HALL DRIVE. You have already made clear that this distinctive character is something that the council wants to preserve, as HS4 requires. Indeed, earlier this month, you have confirmed confirm the tree preservation order 397 for FARR HALL DRIVE, further emphasising your commitment to the character of the local area. Work is at present underway to extend the protected area of Lower Village HESWALL to include FARR HALL DRIVE. The current proposal is for a single dwelling compared to the two that were refused, but a comparison of the plan shows that it is for a single dwelling that would extend almost completely across the width of the plot, over 139% increase on the original footprint. Whilst the previous proposal had at least some break between the two dwellings, this proposal does not even have that. The scale of the proposal, as viewed from FARR HALL DRIVE, is at least as great as that which the committee has already refused. It is clear from the street scene diagrams and perspective drawings, the similar scale and massing that you have already refused, the proposed dwelling would completely dwarf its neighbours. It would have a frontage to FARR HALL DRIVE of almost 23 metres, 75 feet. Its ridge height is even higher than the previous refused application. So your reason for refusal on the earlier application applies equally to this application. I hope you are able to see that this application has the same faults as the previous one that you refused. An approval in this case would be giving developers the green light to harm the character of FARR HALL DRIVE. Developers are already lining up with other proposals that would similarly harm the character of the area and destroy the benefits of the right-of-way, i.e. application 190068 for 6 apartments at number 41 FARR HALL DRIVE and 190091010 for the same number of apartments at 22 FARR HALL DRIVE. Both proposals in place of single dwellings and both within 3 houses of each other. I hope you will agree that it is absolutely the right time for this committee to reaffirm its earlier decision that the character of FARR HALL DRIVE should be protected in line with HS4 and that it will not allow it to be redeveloped site by site so that in 5 years' time the character and the benefits for all will be lost. There are some serious problems with the proposals, as the officer's report does recognise, mostly importantly about whether prospective and future owners of the new property would enjoy sufficient privacy. Because as the planning officer noted in his report, the new house bedroom windows look directly into the main living rooms of bedroom number 45. There is issues of poor design, for example. The officer's report also states that the front road facing elevation is out of balance. In addition, planning guidance, appendix 1, specifically distances between properties within this application, several distances are below the standard required and incorrectly stated in the planning officer's report. I'll give you some indication of those in a moment. And we have mentioned before in this committee the ongoing drainage and flooding problems in FARR HALL DRIVE. These are not gone away. 4 incidents in July 2019 alone. Welsh Water have still not taken any meaningful action to address these issues. I have pictures of raw sewage in people's garden this year. I will not show these to the committee for fear of turning your stomachs. On all these design issues, you will be aware that the government has just published its National Design Guidance on Planning Practice, Power 17, recognised the critical role that the local communities play in achieving successful and well-designed buildings. We recognise that developers wish to create a more marketable property or better use of the site, and local people would be happy, only pleased to work with it to create develop, which you can achieve. Just before conclusion, I just want to point out some anomalies on the officer's proposal. I was quite surprised that he put the proposal through with approval with these faults on it. And certain work that actually haven't been done. Will one of Hans' guidance, appendix 1. 1.1, 21 metres required between habitable rooms to avoid overlooking where level differences occur. The distance required increasing by 2 metres for every 1 metre difference in levels. This means that the level difference approximately 3 metres hence, The dimension should be 21 plus 3 times 2, 27 metres should be allowed. The actual distance on the plan is 18 metres, so that's not been correct. Where the windows face, 1.2, where the windows face a blank wall, a distance of 14 metres times 3.2, because of the levels, should be 20 metres, should be allowed. The actual distance is 11. It should not have an adverse impact on or be so large as to create an effect of overdominance or cause a significant amount of visual intrusion or significantly affect existing levels of daylight or sunlight. As sketches, the officer's already said it's got an overlooking problem into other people's property. The 45 degree rule in the appendix has been ignored, which is a general planning principle to ensure light is not taken away from the existing neighbours' dwellings. See the sketches and the distances. No proposed finished floor levels. Now this is the one that got me, because if you look at the plans, their FARR HALL DRIVE drops away, and even on the plot of the Mundens, where the house, the original house is, it takes quite a fairly dip drop. Now, there's nothing stopping you approve this tonight, that chap can go raise the level to where the existing house is, and then put this house that you've just passed even higher on the plot, because there's no levels approved in this planning application. So no finished floor levels of the street scene have been submitted to show the effects of the steeply sloping sides, so it's not possible to form an accurate impression of the impact of the proposal. No site levels have been provided on the drawings, hence the comparative size of height of the new house cannot be assessed. There is no ridge height, and so the true height of the building is not available. In planning report 3.10.3, the statement is incorrect, and the offer is ignored in Wirral Council's own adopted policy given in Appendix 1. The main side elevation be at least 9.5 metres from the boundary shared in number 45. This is totally incorrect. The distance to the boundary is 3.1 metres. 18 metres for the side elevation of number 45, this is totally incorrect. The distance is 5.3 metres. So there's a lot of discrepancies here on this planning application. The main living room and bedroom windows facing the estuary are 18 metres from the rear windows of the new dwelling. Appendix 1 requires a distance of 24 metres, plus 2 metres for every metre in level. The distance should be 27 metres. Hence, the proposed planning application is 18 metres in total. It's inadequate. Bedroom and main living room windows would be obstructed by the new house and not unobstructed as in 3.10.3. Privacy 3.10.3 states the bedroom windows and main living room are orientated towards the development site and estuary as all original houses. The officer reports this is arguable at the expense of the privacy of the prospective occupiers. Hence, there is obviously a privacy issue which is in conflict with planning policy and Appendix 1. Drainage, the planning application form still contains an incorrect statement that the surface water will discharge into a water course when there is no water course in the area. In conclusion, the officer's report fails to consider this application in the context of your previous refusal. The council has confirmed the reasons for its earlier refusal in its statement to the inspector on the appeal. The appeal has not given a decision yet. A comparison of the scale of this proposal with the previous proposal makes it clear that the only logical and consistent decision that could be made would be to refuse this current proposal for the same reasons as your early refusal and in line with the requirements of HS4. Approval of this proposal would completely undermine the position that the committee has already adopted. On applicant's drawings, 511P002B shows a for a regrading of the site, and yet no proposed finished floor levels for bricks levels. This has not been addressed in the officer's conditions. Thank you.
Thanks for that. Any members have any questions they would like to pose against them?
So even, yes, right, if the land levels were leveled off,
43 would actually then become lower, yeah.
And so the point is, if on this application there are no land site levels approved, then there is nothing to stop the applicant levelling the land and building up, and therefore separation distances wouldn't be adequate, because you then have to have 2 metres of room.
So you can actually tell, but we can condition that so that the interface distances aren't eroded.
No, not as you can see from what you said, based on the plans that were submitted. But if those plans are changed, over, are you saying that you could mitigate that possibility with a condition as opposed to asking for new plans to be submitted and then as?
Yes, that's right. Yes, so we can add a condition that requires land levels to be submitted, both existing and conditional levels.
As well, also, Councillor Rowland's made mention of 310.3, and I'd like to draw some attention to the fact that it says the main dwelling is considered a sufficient distance away to comply with the above mentioned interface distances. Whilst number 45 features two door windows secondary to the main window within first floor rear elevation within the roof space orientated towards the development site, the view, arguably at the expense of the privacy of the prospective occupiers, would be unobstructed. So the point I wanted to make was, in Farr Hall Drive, you would expect to see a property that the size of the plot, vastly different, of course, from the HMOs that we've been looking at previously, but you would expect on a plot that size that a house was situated in relation to the plot size, that you would never have to see an item in an officer's report that alludes to arguably at the expense of the privacy of the prospective occupiers. It's suggesting, therefore, that although it might just about meet the interface distances from the next door neighbour, number 45 to number 43. But from 40, looking at it from the perspective of 43 to 45, it's saying that it's at the expense of the privacy of the prospective occupier. Basically saying, I would say, that the privacy of number 45 is reduced because of the closeness to number 45, so the other way around.
I think what the officers alluded to in the report is that the privacy of any future occupiers will be eroded because of the provision of the two-door windows overlooking their garden. But that's no different from the current situation, that the existing dwelling is situated, you know, almost as a bigger footprint, but in the roughly the same area. So the dormer windows from number 45 look into the garden of number 43.
Would you suggest that the interface distances on this particular plot are only just met?
I would concur that they are met.
What I mean is only just met. The reason I'm asking is that I feel that this is an overdevelopment of this particular plot. It's all relative, isn't it, to what house you're looking at in what area. And in Farr Hall Drive, the character of the area will be eroded if properties are built that are of such an extreme size that they only just meet separation distances where you would expect that these plots to retain the character of the area are well within separation distances. So the separation distances should never even be an issue. I mean, we get some reports on properties in HESWALL, but you don't even have to mention because, you know, they're miles apart. But what I'm saying is this one looks as if it only just meets. And if the applicant raises the level, and I know you say it can be conditioned, then in actual fact separation distances would be met. And you'd have to argue then that in terms of this particular plot size and the character of Farr Hall Drive, that this is an overdevelopment of this particular site.
If the applicant raises the land levels, or we can apply a condition that controls that, so that wouldn't be an issue. It is, this area was characterised by large houses within large plots. Different designs of buildings built in different areas, but one of the main things is that helps set the character of the area is the landscaping throughout, and that's not going to change in any way, shape or form.
I actually, we know the site fairly well. We've been north on the site as it's been to the committee before, as you well know. And the first protocol I come for is, would you be able to, in an appeal situation, there was an accusation of some inconsistency. Actually, the officers have been entirely consistent. They recommended approval of the other application I referred to, and they referred approval of this one. So, recommended approval of this one. So, there's a level of consistency at the professional level. And I'd be interested to hear some of the arguments or what reasons for refusal could come forward. I think the developer has made an attempt to mitigate what was said last time, and I think the officers can mitigate any issues about separation distances with any relevant condition about site levels. So at the moment, I also come to every committee with a very open mind. At the moment, I am moving towards being in favour, because I can't really, in my own heart, I can't really find demonstrable harm or reasons that would be defendable for demonstrable harm as a basic principle of planning. But I'll be interested to see what reasons of refusal may or may not, what other arguments may come up on that. As I always say, this is a finely balanced, I think the vote last time was very finely balanced, I remember. A finely balanced application. At the moment, my balance is towards that improvement, but I've listened to other arguments.
I do have words for review if anybody else, unless anybody else wants to speak. Chair, about the application.
I'm just looking at the handout that was given to all members when we first came in, and it's on the third page. It's with regards to the existing footprints of 6 metres squared. And the proposed footprints 253 metres squared. First of all, did the officers recognise those sizes? And if that is 139% increase in the footprints, is that allowable? Are there any restrictions on that?
In policy terms, there's no restriction on increasing in the floor area in a primary residential area. There is, in the Wirral, for example, but not in a primary residential area, as long as the character is maintained.
The reasons I have for refusal are as follows. Reason for refusal for planning application APP/19/01182, Little Mundens 43 Farr Hall Drive, HESWALL. Contrary to National Policy Planning Framework HS4, the proposed building is not of a scale that relates well to the surrounding properties, in particular with regard to existing densities and forward development, and would result in a detrimental change in the character of the area.
More than the one that we refused, so the issue. course, the seats would be quite simple. Just looking at the front seats. And there are some, there's some tree cover, and those officers are also talking about our cultural condition that will maintain that that coverage. Character is always a subjective issue, I guess. But it's not an area where demolition would require any planning permission. We just require prior approval notification. So, in a sense, the applicant could demand that aspect of the application's redundant, so they could flatten within it. And then we will be left with the site. So that's our starting point. There's the site. What is it reasonable to put on it? So we have an application in which the separation distances we are assured are met, and that the issues that were raised in terms of the plot size for the previous application seem to have been met. I'm not too sure in my own mind whether the reason to give up for refusal would stack up. Nevertheless, it's been moved. If anybody else has any comments to make, we'll test the view of the committee. So, we see those in favour of refusal now, please. Okay. And those against? Okay, so these have been lost.
I would move approval with the extra conditions that have been reduced tonight, and also a definite extra condition about land cycles.
Okay, the second is?
Chair, just before we go to votes on that, this isn't an aside, anyway, but from what Steve's just spoken about tonight. I can make comparisons to one of the application vice versa for my own wards, not so long ago. I'm looking at the size of the gable. The immense proportions of it in comparison to what I'm guessing is 41 on the other side. Now, whilst these conditions are going to be imposed on it, presuming it goes through the conditions that are there, can we actually ensure that they stick to the proposal, to the conditions that actually are imposed upon them? Because I wouldn't like to see a scenario like in my ward just a couple of months ago, where the developer goes and does whatever he wants anyway, he just puts a subsequent application in. Retrospective, and we're never going to make him knock it down, so he just gets passed. So can we try to actually like carry out some inspections and maybe some enforcement during the process?
I'm pretty sure this developer will be watched like a hawk through every stage of the development. I mean, we are again a planning committee, we've asked for conditions and we will try, we will enforce them. That would be my view. But, you know, the application, each application is taken on its own merits, and we can't really quote other applications too much. And, you know, things like
operational.
Well, I accept the councillor's concern, but we have a move there and a second.
Okay, the point's been made, Tony, thank you for that. And, hopefully the conditions are the conditions, the outside conditions are the first. Should it be approved, I'm not sure how much we've got. No doubt we'll hear from the War Council. We'll have to balance that as it goes. Any further comments or observations? Those in favour of approval, then.